Why the difference? Right? Many times they just say, that he doesn't even say the Ben Bnei Israel. Many times it's just Moshe Rabbeinu who speaks, and that's it. So what is these nuances? So let me see if we can figure out what it means, El Kol Adat Bnei Israel. Let's start with that. Okay? So it says, Malel Im Kol Kenishta Dibnei Israel. What does Kenishta Dibnei Israel mean? What does the word Kenishta mean?
Knesset?
Milashon Knesset. So what does Adat Bnei Israel mean? Adat usually refers to the leaders of the Jewish people, right? So you have the Ime'ine Ha'ida Ne'esta Bishkaga. So here you're speaking to Adat Bnei Israel. It says a Kenishta di Israel. So why is that? What does it refer to Adat Bnei Israel? So here, look at Rashi. Rashi says, "Melamed sheneemra perasha zo behikahel." This perasha was stated in a formal gathering of the nation. There was a formal gathering of the nation to convey this perasha. I want to explain what this means. All the Torah was taught by Moshe Rabbeinu to the Jewish people in Ohel Moed. But there was a certain aspect to it that was voluntary. What do I mean? It's as follows. In the case of Aharon, he came to study with Moshe, every single pasuk. In the case of Bnei Aharon, they studied with Moshe, every single pasuk. In the case of the 70 elders, they studied with Moshe, every pasuk. But then came the nation. The nation, that was the last step, that was voluntary. It was Kol Mevakesh Hashem. Anybody that wanted to get the word of God would enter Ohel Moed and would study Torah with Moshe Rabbeinu. That was optional in that sense, because there were those who couldn't make it to Ohel Moed for whatever reason. Or maybe they made it one day, then they make it another day. But then the people who made it to Ohel Moed, they would go and spread out through the nation and teach the Torah to the rest of the people who didn't make it. This parasha is different. This parasha included the full gathering of the Jewish people. So this wasn't optional. This was a parasha which was required that every Jew be present when Moshe Rabbeinu convey this message. Do you understand that point? That's an important point. And it tells you how important the parasha was. Yes? Does a full gathering indicate there was a berit being made? That's a very nice question. Well, I mean, at this point, there was no berit being made because actually the berit was already made in Har Sinai prior to this parasha. But what it indicates is that the berit is based upon the terms contained in this parasha, right? Because when the Jewish people accepted the berit, they said na'aseh v'nishma. And na'aseh v'nishma meant that, in fact, they didn't know the terms of the berit yet. So this parasha is important, and what you're pointing out is quite significant in that there is, in fact, an element of this parasha which is related to the berit because it contains the summary of the. So, muted? Okay, no, it isn't. My microphone is not muted. Man, I'm not used to using Zoom on my phone. So forgive me for the thing. Hold on 1 second. Any other questions?
Rabbi, let's have the class next week in shul.
Who said that?
Me, MG.
MG, how do you figure we're going to do it in shul? Okay, hold on 1 second. Mr. MG, how do you figure we're going to do it in shul?
We get the key, we go inside, we keep it low key, no alcohol.
Wise guy. Okay, back to the class. We'll talk about it. We'll talk about it next week. Okay, let's continue. All right.
So can we? So we can say, I guess, Mamad Har Sinai, then, and this parasha, and by Hakhel, were the three only times where you had the full nation in theory?
No, I don't agree with that. For example, also when let me find you another pasuk. When Hashem spoke to the Jewish people to bring the Korban Pesach, right? That was also a gathering of the full Jewish people. So there's different cases in the Torah where there was a gathering of the full Jewish people, right? And it refers to Eidah in several cases. But certainly here it's one of those places. So that's important to be aware of. And it says the primary message is Qedoshim Tihiyu, right? And what is the idea of Qedoshim? So as I explained in my son's bar mitzvah this week, for those of you who were there online, there was, the idea is that Qedoshim means perushim. And perushim means to be separate. So what are you separating from? So here's the point. Man is created, Adam Nivra Afar Min Ha'adama, right? Man is created from the soil of the earth. And because we're created from the soil of the earth, we have certain natural tendencies, right? We have certain biological aspects to us. So when the Pasuk says, Qedoshim Tihiyu, and the Chachamim say, Perushim Tihiyu, you have to be separate. It means separate yourselves from those parts of you, those aspects of you that are connected to the Adama. And what is Harambam? If you know the answer, you can unmute yourself. Harambam has a Sefer Qedusha. What are the two subjects dealt with in Sefer Qedusha? Who knows? One of them is Ilchot Isure Bi'ah, forbidden sexual behavior. And the second is Ma'akalot Asurot, forbidden food. Right? So you see how the connection is between, on the one hand, those biological tendencies, and Qedusha, which says, wait, hold on, you're not an animal. And because this is the essence of the Berit, the essence of the Berit is the attempt to hiyuli mamlechet kohanim begoy chadosh. That's why this parasha was stated behikahel el kol adat ben Israel, because this is the essence of who we are as a nation. Now, why is it so important for us to be kedoshim? And the answer is ki kadosh, because I myself am kadosh. What does it mean Hashem is kadosh? Who can explain that to me? Anybody venture to guess? But you have to know that it's not a simple answer. But if you think you have something to contribute, I'd like to hear it. What does it mean that Hashem is kadosh?
Separate.
Okay. From what? Yeah, separate. From what?
From us, from the world.
Okay. First of all, you're right. You're right. He's separate. Jay Grossman is adding from all of his creations. Correct. Let me explain. There is nothing in this world that somehow can condition Hashem or can somehow affect a change in Hashem or change Hashem. Hashem is the highest level of Kedusha, because this Kedusha is unlike any other Kedusha. There is no connection between Hashem and the world that Hashem created, right? Let me explain what I mean when I say there was no connection, because that's actually a dramatic statement, which I just wanted to say it so you hear it. I'll give you an example. Let's say now I have an amazing idea for a movie, and I write the story, I write the script, and in the movie, there are all these characters, and I bring them alive. I bring them alive in this movie, and it's an amazing movie, and it's an amazing story. but that's a different level of existence. Hashem's level of existence is different than the book that Hashem wrote. The same way the author is not inside the book, right? So the book doesn't change the author. Rather, it's the author who's creating the book and who's affecting the book and who's making the characters act in certain way. Perhaps it gives the characters certain independence, like in the case of Adam, who has Bechira Chofshit. But that's why Hashem is Kadosh, and Hashem is saying, if you want to get closer to me, separate yourself from this existence, because people are always acted upon from the outside. The outside world affects us. The outside world gives us certain instincts, certain desires, certain proclivities. I get angry because of what happens around me. Let go of that, right? Let go of all those things, because the more you let go of that, the greater your Qedusha, and the more similar you become, similar, you become to God. And by becoming similar in that sense to God, when I say similar, I mean only in the level of Kedusha, that you're separating yourself, you attain a greater understanding of who God is. That's Kedusha. And that's what the Jewish nation is. We are the Kadosh nation. Okay. Let me continue now in the next pasuk. And I know I didn't say barakah, because last time I said barakah twice, even though I believe that was heseach dat, because if you know, but I'm going to say another barakah. Baruch ata Adonai, Eloheinu melech ha'olam, shehakol nihiya bidbaro.
Amen. So it says, ki kadosh ani, in that pasuk, I don't see the tag, right?
Yeah, ki kadosh. Ani Adonai Eloheinu. Your God, your Lord is Kadosh. You want to have a relationship with me? Make yourself Kadosh, right? You want to have a relationship with, what's the name of the quarterback in the New England Patriots? Manning, right? You're going to talk about football with him, right? You're not going to talk about the Russian ballet, correct? You want to have a relationship with the intelligent person, Jordan Peterson? Talk about politics with him, right? You want to have a relationship with God? He's Kadosh. You ain't going to have no relationship with me if you're stuck in the earth. Pick yourself up, become Kadosh, then approach me, because you understand something about what Kedusha is, and I am holy Kadosh. Okay. Let's read the next pasuk. Okay. Ish imo ve'aviv tira'u ve'etchob betoltai tishmoru ani Adonai Elohechem gevar min imme umin abuhi tehon dachalin. Beyat Yomesh Shabbaya, delete Terun Ana Adonai Elahachon. Okay, so now, first of all, Ish Imo, every man, for his mother, for his father, must have fear. I like the word awe more than fear in this context, because the word fear implies that somehow I'm afraid of, you know, something that could harm me. I like the word awe. It's a greater word. And I would say that the relationship, or the way a person must view one's parents, is kind of like, let's say, when you see a Sefer Torah or when you say Tefillin, it's Davar Kadosh. You're not going to be lightheaded in the presence of a Sefer Torah. You're not going to act improperly in the presence of a Sefer Torah. So, Ish Imo Ve'aviv Tira'u means every man should have that fear, that awe of their parents. Ve'etchabetotai tishmoru. Similarly, you must guard the Shabbat. By guard the Shabbat, it means do not violate the Shabbat. I will explain in a moment the relationship between those two things. I will explain. But first I want to look at Rasag. I'm looking at Rasag, and he says L'chaf. Chaf, what is Chaf? Like Chof Allah. What does Chof Allah mean?
Like Bechaf.
Like, yes, like to have fear. To have fear, right? And here's what the Benu Sadegon says. How do you attain Kedusha? And the answer is, you attain Kedusha first. The starting point is Sheyira kol Adam et imo ve'et aviv. Every person should have that feeling of awe from their parents. Again, awe in the sense of this is something holy and I have to be careful the way I act here. It's not just another person. And continuing in Rabbeinu Sadia Gaon, and I'm just, my eyesight is not what it used to be when I was younger, so I have trouble looking at little smaller letters. V'shamiru v'shimru etchabetotai, right? Egmol lach ani Hashem Elokechem, and for this I am God. I will reward you for these things. Meaning, if for the misvav kibud avaim, the Torah gives a special reward. For the Shabbat, there was a special reward. So on the one hand, one has to have fear of the parents. One has to guard the Shabbat. But on the other hand, Hashem is saying, and you will get rewarded for this. Now let me explain what this is about. Oftentimes, when we become religious, when we decide to come close to religion, it happens, and I've seen this, unfortunately, as a rabbi, where people make teshuvah and they cut off their ties from their parents because of the fact that they made teshuvah, meaning not because something that their parents did, but rather they feel now that they're religious, that their parents are somehow inferior to them. And what the Torah is telling us is the exact opposite. It doesn't matter who your parents are. You have an obligation to be in awe of them because they, like God, created you, right? And the Chachamim say, Shelosha shutafim la'adam, aviv ve'imo ve'hakadosh baruch hu. And just by virtue of the fact that they created you, you have to be in eternal awe and a sense of humility in their presence, right? So if somebody becomes religious, quote unquote, and because of him becoming religious, this impels him to disrespect his parents, then I can say the following. He's not going in the ways of Kedusha. He's actually going away from the ways of Kedusha, because the ways of Kedusha fully align with respecting and being in awe of one's parents. That's the parents. Let's look at Shabbat. What happened on Shabbat? On Shabbat, the world no longer was created. And we recognize the Shabbat. Why? What's so special about that? Can somebody tell me what's so special about that? And this is going to answer the first part, why we have to respect and be in awe of our parents. Somebody tell me, what is so special about the Shabbat, about the fact that on the Shabbat, the world was no longer created? Who can answer that question? You can answer in the chat, or you can answer via by speaking out loud. I will not attack or, you know, be mean. Any thoughts? I'll tell you what. Shabbat, Hashem looks at the world and he says, that's it, I'm done. What does that tell you about the world? If Hashem is looking at the world and he says, that's it, it's done.
It's perfect.
Thank you. Who said that?
No comment, Elliot.
Elliot, Zaku Baruch. What do we say in the Kaddish? We say, Be'al Mavi Berachiruteh. What does Be'al Mavi Berachiruteh mean? In this world that Hashem created in accordance with his rason, with his will. So Hashem creates the world and there is nothing missing in the world. It's all there. And he looks at the world and now it's Shabbat and it's perfect. You know what that means? When you look at your parents and you're angry, that means you're not appreciating the world that Hashem created for you. There's a meaning to that. So we may say, oh my, you know, I know like many, you know, many people, it's not unusual, are frustrated. The parents are either too religious, not religious enough, this issue, that issue, and these issues indeed may be real issues. I'm not saying they're not real issues. But I'm saying a person has to realize that Hashem put you in the exact situation that you should be in. And when you look at that situation, you should be in awe of what God did to you. And if you're not in awe, if you don't understand the awesomeness of where you are, you're missing it. So if you look at Shabbat, you say, wow, that's perfect. And if you look at the world that you came from, maybe you came from Chiloni parents and now you're religious. There's something about that should make you in awe. Maybe you came from parents who have a particular defect. Maybe you came from parents who were wonderful. Maybe you came from parents who were such, that gave you so much. Whatever it is, be in awe of it. There's a message there from God. And there's something there that's connected to who you are. But you have to find it. You have to find it. You understand the point of the Pasuk? That's part of Qedusha. Part of Qedusha, to summarize, be in awe of the world that Hashem created, whether it's the big global universe that we call the universe, or the private world that He gave you two parents. There's something special there. You just have to find it. All right? I'm now going to continue with your permission, unless there's a question. Any questions? She'elot? Okay. So I'm going to continue now. And in order to, just give me a moment to just, no, that's it. Okay. All right. Al tifnu el ha'elilim velohe masecha lo ta'asu lachem ani Adonai Elohechem la titenon batar ta'avan vedachlan tematecha la ta'abidun lechon ana Adonai Elachon. Okay. Al tifnu el ha'elilim. Lifnot means the face. Milashon panim. Al tifnu means do not turn your face towards these foreign gods. Let me look at Ankelos. We said, la titpenon batar ta'avan. Lo tifnu achar ta'uyot. So ta'avan means the mistakes, right? Any foreign god is a mistake. So we refer to these foreign gods as mistaken gods. Okay? So that's a way interesting how Ankelos refers to the Elilim, the foreign gods.
Acham.
Yes, sir.
Does Ankelos do this otherwise in with Avodah Zarah calling it Ta'uyot in any others?
You're saying in other perashiyot, like Shofetim and Shotenim, and other places like this? Yes.
Yeah, I'm curious. I've never seen this before, calling them Ta'avan like this. But maybe
right.
And
just to be clear, it's Tet Ayin Vavnun. Let me get Perashat Shofetim because this is the book of. Give me a moment. I'm going to get the book of Perashat Shofetim. Okay. Here we go. What I can tell you is that Ankelos oftentimes does not give a literal translation, so that's not uncommon.
I found it. He actually does use it.
Ta'avan, right?
Yeah, in Pasuk Gimal and Peret Zayin in Shofetim, he says, "Va'azal uflah le'ta'avat amemaya."
There you go.
So he actually uses it.
Yep. Okay. That's the Pasuk I was looking for. You found it before me. Hazak Baruch. Okay, answer the question. Okay. Okay. So that's Elilim. Now, interesting, it says, "Al tifnu el ha'elilim." It doesn't say don't pray to the Elim. Altifnu, what does it mean? Altifnu? What doesn't it say? Don't pray to them. You understand my question? I'll explain to you. Of course, it's forbidden to pray to Avodah Zarah. That's simple. But what about if I'm just facing it? What does it mean to face it? It means I give it some significance. So I'll tell you the way Harambam understands this. There's people who believe in God, but they feel that somehow there is significance to different, idols and different spirits. and they feel that through these idols and spirits, they can reach the one true God, right? It says, Al tifnu. Don't even, forget about worshiping these gods for their own sake. Even to worship God, you're just facing these elilim, and they're going to be some sort of intermediary. Even that's haram. Elohim asecha lo tasu lachem. Elohim asecha, I'm going to tell you what Ankelo says. He says, idols of metal. Masecha tematecha. Tematecha. Meaning of matechet, of metal. And also Seadia Gaon says, I'm reading you now, Seadia Gaon, v'ne'abde matechet. Right? So they used to make idols made out of various metals, whether it's gold, silver, copper, and they thought that that brought a certain, you know, awesomeness. And it says, doesn't say not to worship them. What does it say? What does lo ta'asu lachem mean? Even to craft, even to design, even to create these idols is haram. Of course, you're not allowed to worship them. But even to make them, it's haram, right? That's the point of the pasuk. Now, let me explain to you that here's the point. Here's a relationship between, you know, father, mother, Shabbat. We did that on the one side, and then the other things, the various gods and spirits on the other side, which is to say that God wants us to worship him, but it has to be in a very specific way. This is really important. We cannot worship, and we are prohibited from worshiping God as we see fit, right? It's not up to us to decide how to worship God. So I know the instinct says, oh, make this beautiful image of gold. What could be more beautiful? Or a beautiful tree, a giant tree, and decorate it. And, you know, through that, we would bring the holiness into our midst. Hashem says, you follow my instructions. You perform the mitzvot as I tell you to perform them. And before each mitzvah, when you perform a mitzvah, before you perform mitzvah aseh, or most mitzvah aseh, you say asher. What's the next word? Asher kedeshanu b'mitzvotav. What does kedeshanu mean? Qedoshim tihiyu. Kedusha. You want to attain holiness? Follow instructions precisely. So first of all, don't make the mistake that other people make. They worship God through gold, through silver, through images. Don't even craft those idols. Even that's haram. Let's continue. V'chi tzbehu zebach shelamim l'adonai v'rsonechem tzbehu v'aret kesun nechsat kudshin kodam adonai d'ra'ava lechon t'kesunehe. Interesting. Okay, let me explain to you the pasuk, the peshat, and then I'm going to read to you some of Ankelos and Rasag and also Rashi. Okay, if you are going to bring a korban of a shelamim in front of God, let me explain to you what the korban shelamim was. The korban shelamim was a korban where the certain portions would go and be burnt on the mizbeach. Mostly the chelev, the kelayot, and very, very minimal parts of the animal were certain parts of the fat, not shuman. There's anything. Chelev is a very particular type of fat, and the kidneys would be burnt on the altar. The rest would be eaten either by the kohanim portions or by the person who brought the korban. So the pasuk says, if you're going to bring this type of sacrifice to the Beit HaMikdash, it has to be something that you desire to bring. That's what it says. What does that mean? What does it mean? It has to be little sonechem. Why else would I bring it? Why else would I bring a zevach shelamim? It says bring it lirsonichem. You understand the question? Okay. Let me first read on Rasag. V'cha'asher tizbechu zebach shelamim ladonai. Hare kefi ma sheyirse mikem tizbechu. He doesn't explain it like I explained it. It says, Rasag says, if you decide to bring a korban shelamim to God, hare kefi ma sheyirse mikem, you should do it as Hashem wants you to do it. Interesting, not what I said. I said, you should bring it with the desire to bring it, your desire to bring it. Rasag didn't say that. You bring it according to his wishes, meaning you follow his instructions. Let me look at Ankelos now. Ankelos. Dechi tishchatu shechitat kodashim lifnei Hashem, lirason lachem tishchatu. Ankelos is like me. He says, you should bring it because you desire to bring it. Okay, let me explain what this means. Okay, I'm first going to explain Rabbeinu Seadia Gaon. Rabbeinu Seadia Gaon follows on the theme that I said in the previous pasuk. When you worship God, you may not make up things. When you worship God, you have to follow the mitzvot and the instructions. And even if you could bring a korban, and even if it's an optional korban, like a zevach shelamim, this has to be according to his instructions. You have to bring the specific animals that he allows. You have to do the shechita. There has to be zerikat adam, kabbalat adam, all the laws. There's a law of pigul. There's a law of notar. There's all these laws. You have to follow them. That's Rabbeinu Seadia Gaon. What does ankelos mean? Ankelos says no. Ankelos says it has to be according to your rason. Why does he say that? Anybody have an idea? Anybody venture to guess?
Isn't the word leratzon used in Perek Aleph when it talks about korbanot?
Yes. Okay.
Leratzon lifnei Hashem. Isn't that one of the prescriptions?
Ki lo leratzon yelachem. That pasuk?
I think earlier in Perek.
Let me see. Give me a moment. Let's see if you find the pasuk. I'm going to look for it also.
That's more like Rasag. El petach ol moed yakriv oto lirsono lifnei Hashem.
Exactly, I found it. Perek Aleph pasuk gimel. That's a korban olah, though. That's a korban olah, and it is like Rasag. You're right, lirsono. That is like Rasag, but here it's a korban shelamim. Korban olah, I can see, absolutely, not even a question. It's all burnt on the mizbeah. There's nothing left. Well, the reason Ankelos here says lirsonechem, not like Rasag, because it's a korban shelamim. So what does that mean? And first, Rasag was, by the way, Rasag. I consider Rasag, my father considers Rasag to be the greatest giant in the Perush of the Tanakh. I mean, he is Perushim are just simply Me'irim Einayim by far. And Ankelos was one of the Tanaim. So, you know, you have like, you know, we're like, to call ourselves midgets in front of Ankelos and Rasag is a compliment. Nevertheless, all I'm saying is I'm not trying to be machria. I don't want to deter. I'm just saying I want to explain what Ankelos meant. And here's what he meant. Lirsonechem. People used to bring korbanot thinking that they can manipulate. And the manipulation of the gods through the bringing of sacrifices is described in great details, one of the perashiot in the Torah. And that is Perashat. Come on. Which Perashah? Who wanted to bring Korbanot to manipulate God? Which Goy king?
Balak.
Balak. That's what Balak is about. That's right. And then there was the king of Israel. And this king of Israel, when he made an avon, he wanted to bring korbanot as a way to manipulate for God, or rather to compensate for the fact that he didn't do what he was supposed to do. And what's the name of this king? And Rabbi Natan, you know the answer because you're teaching the books. I know you know the answer.
So many kings I'm teaching about, I'm thinking right now.
Shaul. Shaul, what happens when he doesn't kill Amalek? he tells Shemuel, I wanted to bring korbanot. I wanted to bring the korbanot to make, you know, to show kavod to God, right? Ki hatat kesem meri. Shemuel tells Shaul, ki hatat kesem meri. You know, when you want to manipulate God. That's right. So when you want to manipulate God by bringing korbanot, this is a person who does meri, who already is who is not following the word of God. God prefers that you listen to him than to bring a korban, right? So that's the point here. If you're going to bring a korban shelamim, an optional korban like a korban shelamim, you're going to bring it, enjoy it, gesundheit, do it. Don't do it for me. Don't do it to manipulate me. Don't do it to do me favors. Do it because you want to bring the korban. It's a moment of kedusha in your life. You want to say thank you to God for something, you know, and you want to enjoy the kedusha of being tahor in the Beit HaMikdash, entering the city of Yerushalayim, kadashim kalim nechalim nifnim min hakela'im. You eat it within the walls of Yerushalayim. You want to do it. That's the reason to do it. But you're going to bring it because you want to manipulate me. You want to, don't do me a favor, don't bring it. That's the omic of Ankelos, and that's why Ankelos explains the Pasuk as he does. There was Rasag and there was Ankelos. Take both Perushim or either Perush, but they're both beautiful Perushim. Okay.
Acham.
Yes.
The Peshat seems to be more like Ankelos because of the way the word is written. It's not a Nif'al, it's Lirsonechem. Not yeratze, like Ankelos is, like Rasag is saying.
Yes.
Meaning the Peshat seems to be like you're saying, like Ankelos, not like Rasag.
Yes, I agree. The Peshat appears to be like Ankelos, but I would venture to guess, having seen these machlokot in Gre'el Hachamim, that he has, I'm sure he has a sevara, even al piya dikduk. That explains his, you know, that would explain or sort of justify his explanation from a dikduk point of view. No problem. Have a good evening, Victor, Victoria. Okay. Okay, let's continue. Ne'om zibhachem ye'achel umemachorat. והנותר עד יום השלישי באש יישרף. אנקלוס. ביומה דיית נכס יתאכיל, וביומה דבת רוהי וד ישתער עד יומה תליטאה בנורה יתוקד. אוקיי, ביום זבחכם, first of all, you bring the korban, for example, it's always going to be in the daytime. So you make shachita on the korban Tuesday in the daytime. That's Beyom Zivchachem. On that day, you can eat the meat of the korban. Beyom, I'm reading Ankelos, Beyom Shi Shachet, on the day that you make shachita, Ye'achel, on that day you can eat it. Uvyoma Debatrohi, on the following day, you can eat it as well. Right? So let me explain to you this, the way this works. You bring the korban on Tuesday. You can eat it Tuesday. You invite the whole family over to Yerushalayim. And you're in the city of Yerushalayim. You can eat it. Tuesday night, you can eat it. Wednesday, you can eat it. But anything that's left over after that is called notar. And notar, the law of the notar has to be burnt in the fire of the Mizbeach. Okay? So that's the Peshat of the Pasuk. I'm going to read one more Pasuk, and then I'm going to explain what this is about. All right. Pasuk Zayin. Ve'im he'achol ye'achel ba'yom ha'shelishi v'gulhu lo yeraseh. Ve'im it'achala it'achil ba'yom ha'telita'a merachaku la yehe lera'ava. Okay, and if you eat it on the following day, meaning, again, you brought the korban on Tuesday, you can eat it Tuesday, you can eat it Tuesday night. You have it Wednesday, you can eat it Wednesday. Wednesday night, meaning sunset, subsequent to Wednesday, from that moment on, if you eat it, it's pigul. Bigul is something that is undesired, something that should be far away. Okay, that's a law of Korban Shelamim. There's two types of Korban Shelamim, but here it's talking about a Korban Shelamim that you eat on the day, you eat the following night, you eat the following day, that's it. From the following night onwards, you can't eat it. What is the point here? What is the point here? And the point again is that even when Hashem allows you to bring a korban to him, you have to bring a sacrifice, and that is sort of a concession that Hashem allows us to bring him korbanot, because Hashem doesn't need these korbanot, right? He instructs us to bring the korbanot, and the korbanot have a therapeutic aspect to them. The korbanot are therapy for us. They help us. As I want to explain this. When I say that the korbanot is a concession, I don't mean to say that the korbanot are not important. I need to emphasize this, because what time is it, by the way? Good, we're good. There is an opinion that some of the korbanot is like not really important, but it was like the Jewish people wanted the korbanot, and because we wanted the korbanot, Hashem agreed to allow us to have korbanot, and it's not, you know, it's not something important. I'm not of that opinion at all. I follow Harambam in the Moneh Nebuchim. I take Harambam very seriously. And I think Harambam has the greatest perush on the korbanot ever. And just so you understand, as I keep saying in my shiurim, Harambam was the pinnacle of the Hachamim of Andalus. But before him, there was generations and generations of Hachamim. So it's not like Harambam was born in a vacuum and just one day woke up and decided to make that up. So Harambam's view on korbanot is aligned with the view of the Hachamim of Andalus, and those Hachamim were the Talmidim of the Geonim and the Talmidim of Chachmei Gemara. It all aligns together. And that view is that the korbanot are a therapy for us. It's a therapy for the human neshama. The human neshama needs to bring a korban. And when we bring the korbanot, we enjoy it. We enjoy it spiritually, and we enjoy it physically, because we actually eat from the meat. So, but when you do that, the same way if you go to a doctor, he gives you a very specific instructions, what medicine to take, how much to take, and when to take it. That's here. That's this. What are you bringing? You're bringing Korban Shelamim. What's the reason? For various reasons. Maybe something very good happened. Maybe you made some extra money. Maybe somebody was cured from a sickness. Maybe you just want to come to the Beit HaMikdash and experience the Shekhinah. It could be many, many reasons. Okay, that's fine. So you come to the Beit HaMikdash. What do you eat? There's certain parts of the Korban you can eat, certain parts you can't eat. When can you eat it? You do it from this till this. We follow the instructions as Hashem gave it to us. You see how important it is, the idea of mitzvah, of following instructions. You cannot deviate, not to the left, not to the right, not to the left. You follow exactly as Hashem gave you the mitzvah. That's very important. And if you don't follow it, the same meat that was davar kadosh, that was basar kadosh, kadashim kalim, right? That same meat becomes pigul. It becomes something that's you push away, that we don't want, right? It's mefugal. You have to burn it in the fire. Let's continue. And one day, Belineder, if you want, I can give a whole shiur or a whole series of shiurim and korbanot based upon Harambam in Chalek Gimel of the Moneh Nebuchim. But that's a subject that's really important. The reason it's important is, again, because there is a view that has it that the korbanot are not important. And humbly, be'anava, I say, no, of course the korbanot are important. The korbanot, many, many of the Tarag Misvot, include the misvot of korbanot. So, of course, they're important. But that's a separate question. That's a separate shiur. Ve'ochel av avono yissa ki et kodesh Adonai lel ve'nichleta ha'nefesh ahi me'ameha. And if a person eats the meat of the korban after the time that he's allowed to eat it, that's haram.
Okay,
Because what is the sin here? What is the sin? It says, "Ki et kodesh Hashem pelel." What does it mean, "kodesh Hashem pelel"? Tell me what the sin here is. Somebody explain to me. What does it mean, "et kodesh Hashem pelel"? He took the holy of God, which was a korban, and he made it. He desecrated it. He made it hol. What does that mean? Explain that. I will explain it. You have this korban. The korban has delicious meat. Why are you eating the meat? Because it's a mitzvah to eat the meat. You may enjoy the mitzvah, that's fine. A lot of mitzvot we enjoy. I love eating. I'm sure I'm going to very much enjoy eating korban Pesach when the time comes. I'm very much going to enjoy the korban Pesach. I know because my mom makes the best zeroah and I love the zeroah. But I can imagine that the korban Pesach is even tastier than my mom's zeroah. Okay, I enjoy it. Why am I eating the korban Pesach? Misvot lo lehenot nitanu. The misvot are not there for us to enjoy them. The misvot are there for us to fulfill them. And here's the point. If you continue eating the korban, when you're not supposed to be eating the korban, you know what that shows? That shows that the reason you ate the korban was because you enjoyed it, because you wanted to eat the korban, because you wanted to derive pleasure. And you just desecrated this korban. Hashem didn't tell you not to eat it. Hashem told you, this is when you're allowed to eat it. Make the mitzvah, perform the mitzvah. You want to enjoy the mitzvah, you get a derived benefit, fine. That's not the reason you're doing the mitzvah. And if that's the reason you're doing it, and you end up eating the korban after the time, you just desecrated something holy. This korban is kadosh. It's like tefillin. And you just desecrated it. Bar minan, you go with tefillin. I don't know. You could have an improper thought in your mind. You have the tefillin on your head, and you're thinking about bar minan, some devarim lo kedoshim. It's a desecration of the tefillin. So here you have a korban. It's up for you to enjoy. Eat the korban and enjoy it while you're doing the mitzvah. But if you're now going to eat it when it's not a mitzvah, karet. What does karet mean? Bar minan. The neshama is cut off. Understood? Okay. Let's continue. Let's continue in the parasha. We have another. And I'm sorry if I'm not looking at all the chats because I'm doing this on my phone, which I usually don't do. And it's, let me just see if there's any chats. I think something just flashed. The chat here. There must be a way. My phone. It's not my fault.
On the bottom right, it says more.
Yeah, I got it. More. Yes, it just came up on the bottom. Thank you, Elliot. Okay. My apologies. All that. Okay, no problem. That's fine. Qedoshim tihiyu, a specific mitzvah in its own right, or is it a general concept? That's a very nice question, by the way. According to Harambam, Qedoshim Tihiyu is not counted as one of the 613 mitzvot. Mm-hmm. Rather, by performing the mitzvot that Hashem gives us, we attain Qedusha, right? So that's an important point. The Qedusha is a result of the mitzvot. It's not that there's something independent from the mitzvot that makes us kadosh. So the only way to attain Qedusha is through the mitzvot. That's a really important point. Right. All right. Let's do another pasuk. All right. Okay, let me see what we have here. Okay, so now you want to harvest the field. You have a wheat field in Israel. The fields in Israel are beautiful. You have a beautiful wheat field. And now it has come time to harvest the wheat. Lo techale. What does lo techale mean? Do not completely harvest the field. Lo techale means to finish. Don't finish the harvest. Rather, pe'at sadecha la tiksol. On the corner of your field, leave aside which you don't harvest. Don't harvest that part. Who knows why? I mean, it's not a difficult question, but nevertheless, because we have an obligation to remember the poor amongst us. So there are people who need food, and they would enter the field, and they would go to that corner which you didn't harvest, and you would give them the opportunity to come in and take the wheat that they need to live on. That's called pe'ah. And then there is leket kesirecha lo telaket. Now, when you harvest the field, so you cut the wheat, you have a sickle, and you use the sickle to harvest the wheat. Sometimes it happens that as you're harvesting the wheat, one or two wheat stalks fall. Those weak stalks that fall, you should not pick them up. Whatever falls down in that manner is called leket. And let the poor come and take the leket for themselves, okay? And the parasha is going to continue on and on. And what's interesting is, and I see it's 9:45, so I'm going to finish the class. What's interesting is that there's almost, I would say, 80% of the parasha from this point onwards, if not more, well, 80%, let's say, has to do with mitzvot, how to behave amongst each other. And it's so important. It's so important how we treat each other as human beings. That really, you can't be a holy nation. You know, if somebody comes into Israel in the days of the Mashiach, and he sees that people are not treating each other nicely, that's not a holy nation. I mean, you know, they don't represent God, obviously. You understand that, right? It's so important that we become a loving nation, where we give charity to the poor, where we speak nicely to each other, where we don't slander each other, where we help each other. That's at the heart of Kedusha. Because if Bar Minan, we're only, you know, Mitzvot Ben Adam LaMakom, that's all we do, and then we're rude to each other, we're dishonest with each other, we're fighting with each other. It's like, wow, what a bad reflection that would have been on our Creator. And thank God that's not the case. That's not the case. So almost all the Mitzvot following now are Mitzvot Ben Adam LaHavero, how to behave. That's so essential for Kedusha as well. So were you able to hear me, or was I talking to myself this whole time?
No, we did.
No, we did.
Yeah, the Wi-Fi started working, I guess.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, so I thank you all for this.
Quick question. Sorry.
Yes.
When those stalks fall, is that considered tzedakah?
Yes. I mean, it's not part of the, right, there's different types of tzedakah, but that's a type of tzedakah, correct. It's a type of tzedakah. It's matanot la'evyonim. There's different types of matanot la'evyonim. There's agricultural matanot. There's more that we could have read in the next few pesukim. But then there's also money. We get the money as we do. So there's different types of things that we get to the aniim.
Got it.
All right?
Thank you.
Of course, with pleasure. Okay, gentlemen.
Monday, Shabbat shalom, Rabbi. Thank you.
Shabbat shalom. And Monday night, we have our Pirkei Avot class. And tomorrow, we, for those of you who do Kabbalah Mincha and the beginning, you know, of this, will be at 7:10 tomorrow, 7:10 Mincha. For those of you who join, all the best. Good night, gentlemen.
Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. Thanks.
All the best.